Well, good morning, everyone. Could I formally open this meeting, and could I please remind everyone to switch off mobile phones and electronic devices, as they do interfere with the sound system. We have received apologies from Hanzala Malik, and the first item for consideration is consideration of a current petition, and the next item of business is an evidence session with the Scottish Government as part of the committee's consideration of petition PE1533 by Jeff Adamson on behalf of Scotland Against Care Tax on abolition of non-residential social care changes for older and disabled people. Members have a note by the clerk and its submissions. And I should point out that the initial stage debut of the NHS Scotland was not sought on the basis that the questions identified initially were more properly a matter for the Cabinet Secretary in the first instance. Following today's evidence session, it may be that the committee will wish to follow up issues specifically with the NHS Scotland. So can I welcome Cabinet Secretary Shona Robison for Health, Wellbeing and Sport, and her officials, David Fotheringham and Mike Liddle, for the Integration and Reshaping Care Division, Scottish Government, to the meeting. And can I invite the Cabinet Secretary to make a brief opening statement, after which we shall move to questions.
Okay, thanks very much, Convener. I certainly welcome the opportunity to speak to the committee today about this issue. I certainly recognise that the concerns that have been raised by people facing a range of challenging disabilities and conditions, their carers and the organisations that work with them. I'm certainly determined that the Scottish Government will continue to work with our local authority partners and indeed our health partners to improve the consistency and fairness of the current approach to charging for non-residential care. I think it is important to consider charging as part of the wider social care system. We need to ensure that resources are in place so that we can have the quantity and quality of social care that people require, and also that any charges are affordable and reasonable. With this in mind, on the 20th of January, I announced a further £100 million investment over 3 years to increase social care capacity and to help reduce the number of people waiting to be discharged from hospital. Charges for social care do allow local authorities to recoup a small part of their expenditure on social care, but we do need to ensure that charges where necessary are fair and affordable. My predecessor, Alec Neil, and I have taken a close interest in the issue of charging for social care, and I'm determined that there should be a fair system for service users. That's why we're working in partnership with COSLA and have ensured, for example, that no one under 65 and in the last 6 months of a terminal illness should be charged for the care they receive at home. And we will set this out in legislation if necessary. I'm certainly happy to explore with the committee and others what more could be done. And indeed, we are in continuing discussions with COSLA about what further action can be taken to create a fairer care charging system. Very happy to take any questions.
Can I thank you, Cabinet Secretary, for your opening comments? And could I also say that the petitioner, Jeff Adamson, is in the gallery today? And Cabinet Secretary, in your letter to the committee concerning the petition, you did say that you were sympathetic and sympathetic to the petition. However, much of your response you discussed was to ensure greater consistency across local authorities rather than abolishing care charges. Cabinet Secretary, do you have a view on the principle of abolishing care charges?
Well, I think, as I said in my opening remarks, we need to look at charging in the round. We certainly are in discussions with COSLA about what more can be done. We need to make sure that we have the capacity within social care, given that a lot of the debate at the moment is around how do we prevent people being delayed in hospital, how do we make sure that people are not admitted to hospital in the first place when they don't have to be. All of that requires us to build capacity in the social care sector, and I guess that's part of the debate and the considerations that we need to give, because there are finite resources, and we need then to decide how best to deploy those finite resources with that in mind. Meanwhile, though, I think it's important, while we have that bigger debate about that balance, that there are issues that need to be resolved. So that's why, as I said in my opening remarks, we looked at the issue of people in the last 6 months of life. That's why COSLA are working at the moment around a new financial assessment to bring more continuity and consistency across local authority boundaries, and why we're talking to COSLA about what more we can do to create a fairer charging system, because I do acknowledge that there are inconsistencies, that there are quite different systems from one local authority to the other. And I think while we have that bigger debate about what is affordable, and in the current context of having to look at the growth of social care and the importance of that, that we do make the current charging system fairer for those who are paying charges. And that is the focus of the discussion we're having with COSLA at the moment.
Mr. Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Considering the variance in charging across the 32 local authorities, has the Scottish Government made any assessment how much it would cost to abolish care charges?
Well, we have, although obviously there are some unknown quantities in that. So we looked at the current income brought in from charges, which was around £50 million. Pounds, and clearly, though, there are unknown issues. For example, how much would that grow potentially if charges were to be removed? I guess that's quite hard to estimate completely, but I think we would probably acknowledge there would be a growth in demand and therefore a growth in costs. And I guess if we were to do that, and although £50 million in the bigger picture of things might not seem like a huge amount, if that £50 million was spent on that, then that's £50 million that's not being spent on growing capacity. So I guess you could equate that to £100 million that could be put into growing social care capacity that wouldn't be. And these are the debates and dilemmas that we have in the current financial climate. We have to make difficult decisions about whether, given the challenges of the need to grow social care, the challenges of delayed discharge, the challenges of a growing ageing population, where is the best place to invest those finite resources? These are discussions, as I say, that we're having with local government and with the NHS as well. And they're not easy to resolve. And it is important that where charges are levied, that they are fairer than they are at the moment. And I'm very keen to progress that. But we do have some very challenging choices to make around investment in social care. Otherwise, we're going to continue to face some of the challenges of not being able to keep people out of hospital and not being able to get them out of hospital as quickly as they need to be, and to make sure that there's adequate care provision there for people who need it.
Thank you.
John.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet
Good
Secretary.
Morning.
The issue in the petition is about the charging regimes that currently exist and the unfairness of the charging regime, and in particular the inconsistency across local authority areas in terms of the charges that are made. I view this as one whereby, and you've made reference on a couple of occasions, Cabinet Secretary, to the delayed discharges, and I look at health boards. Health board boundaries are not coterminous with local authority boundaries. So potentially, because of the inconsistency that exists across local authorities, take my own area, for example, in Lanarkshire Health Board, covers three or four different local authorities. Three or four local authorities who have different care charging systems. And could you not see there being a potential for some individuals actually pursuing a delayed discharge because they cannot afford the charging regime that applies in their local authority, while in other areas there may be greater scope for discharge because the care system doesn't charge as much?
I mean, I think you make a fair point. I guess part of the complexity of delayed discharge is that some local authorities have greater social care capacity, some are able to recruit staff easier than others, some have more provision of care homes, some have greater provision of home care services, some have more intermediate care beds. So I think each area has some different challenges to another. That may be a part of it, but I think there's probably other issues going on there as well that lead to some of the differences and particular challenges of delayed discharge being worse in one area than another. Although, having said that, and I've made this very clear, delayed discharge is a problem throughout the system at the moment, and that's something we're absolutely focused on resolving. But your point about inconsistencies is a fair one, and that's why COSLA have been working on this new financial assessment framework, so that what's taken into account in terms of income and things that are disregarded, that there's more consistency around that. However, as I said in my opening remarks, we're in discussions with COSLA about what more can be done. There are issues around when, at what income level people start to pay charges, for example. That is one area in terms of tackling inequalities that is an area that I think has some importance. And then there's the issue, I guess, of people with complex needs. So I suppose to summarise, it is work in progress, the discussions we're having with COSLA, and I'm sure the committee will understand that, you know, these are difficult and challenging and complex discussions, and we need to make sure that if we do one thing, it doesn't have a knock-on effect on something else, and that we look at this in the round about what more could we do to create a system that is fairer, that maybe addresses some of the inequalities that are there within the charging system at the moment, and brings more of a consistency to address some of the issues that you're very much raising. And of course, with integration come the 1st of April, again, I think these issues of consistency have even more importance. So you can be assured that we are absolutely in the middle of discussions with COSLA about what more we can do to help move that forward in a positive way.
Cabinet Secretary, I accept your response. The issue, however, is the issue about the length of time it's taking us to get to a conclusion. The working group's been in existence for 3 years. And the COSLA's response in the last paragraph indicates that they'll be working over the next year on a number of issues. And really, do you, Cabinet Secretary, have a timescale in your own mind about how you'd like to see all those issues being wrapped up so that we do get some consistency, but we get some coordination in terms of the service delivery for people who require those care services? Because I know in amongst the COSLA response, one of the issues about, it's not just about household incomes, it's about taking on board partners' income as well, which I think may be a worrying sign for some individual households. And we've seen in the past where in other areas where partners' incomes have been included, you end up getting separations, divorces or whatever, because people then feel that they're actually being financially undermined because of the care charges that are applied and the disproportionate charges on someone who may be living in that household.
I mean, I can understand your frustration, the committee's frustration at the length of time that some of these things take. I suppose it's a reflection of the complexity of the issue, that a couple of things that have happened during that time, referred to earlier, there has been progress on the issue of the charging for those under 65 with a terminal illness, and I think it's quite right that that was resolved. It wasn't fair that someone was being charged for end-of-life care. The other issue, of course, that's about to be finalised is this new financial assessment framework, which will help with some of the issues about what one local authority disregards and what another disregards. So I guess it's incremental steps of progress rather than perhaps something that is a bit quicker. However, in terms of timeframe going forward, as I say, we are in some very detailed discussions with COSLA at the moment about what more can be done. Obviously, we would want to bring those to a conclusion as quickly as possible, but we are keen to try and get this right because it is an issue that keeps surfacing, and we want to try and, if we're going to do more around fairer charging, get something that's going to be sustainable and see us into the long term rather than coming back and revisiting this issue time and time again, as it has done over the past. So I hope you forgive us for maybe taking that bit more time. But as I say, we are in detailed discussions with COSLA at the moment about what more can be done. And as soon as those discussions are reaching any conclusion, I would be more than happy to come back to the committee with that detailed information.
Cabinet Secretary, you indicated discussions with COSLA coming to a conclusion. As I asked earlier, do you have any timescale in mind? Because I know the incremental steps have been taken, but for many individuals and households out there, they want an answer to the questions that have been raised about the charging regimes that apply sooner than later. And I'd be interested whether or not you do have a timescale that you and your department are working towards to try and get a conclusion to this issue.
Well, I guess it's always as soon as possible, but if I put a time frame on it and then that time frame slipped, and because you know we hadn't reached conclusions in those discussions, I'm not sure how helpful that would be. I certainly want to try to bring those discussions to agreement and conclusion as quickly as we can. But as I say, I would be more than happy to make sure that the committee gets early notification of that once we're in a position to do so.
You are aware, Cabinet Secretary, under the 2002 legislation, the Scottish Government could set charges if they so wished, if they felt there wasn't getting that support from COSLA members. Has that been part of the deliberations and discussion, and I'm not talking about with COSLA, but within the department and yourself?
COSLA and ourselves are well aware of that because obviously we've said in relation to the six months end-of-life care and the fact that council shouldn't be charging for that, that if required we would enact the 2002 legislation. So I think you know we're all aware of the power that we have there, but trying to take this forward in the spirit of partnership, we've got the new integrated partnerships starting on the 1st of April, the fact that we all recognise that resources are challenging and we need to make sure that where we spend the money is going to have the biggest impact and the biggest help to make sure that social care delivers in the way we need it to deliver, that we, you know, we need to have caution around what decisions we make, and that has to be done really in consultation and negotiation rather than any other way. But yes, we are of course aware of that.
Right, thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary.
Just a follow on from that, Cabinet Secretary, I did notice in some of the evidence that with regards to the income that's been generated from social care services, that a lot of it was not being put back into the service. Have you any comment to make on that?
From my discussions with local government, I think I would, to be fair to councils, they are quite often, certainly spending their social work budgets. I don't think there's a case of them not spending the resource that they have on social care. I think the opposite, actually. I think councils are, in the main, doing what they can to meet those increasing demands. I guess one of the, you know, the challenges is about how do we make better use of our collective resources, which is why integration is so important, because it's the benefits of making sure that those integrated teams, that they're working closer together, will make that social care spend have more impact than it currently has at the moment. But I don't get the sense that local authorities are holding money back in the social care arena. Certainly that's not my impression from the evidence that we have.
From the analysis that we've done within Scottish Government on looking at what the actual costs of collection of the charges are, we think that it's likely to be about 15% of the income that's generated from charging that is actually that would be releasable, you know, would be the actual cost of administering those charges. So it's probably a very small figure compared to, I think, probably about half of what is in the Scotland Against the Care Tax evidence, we think, is likely to be the actual figure.
Sorry, I understood your question, Convener, to be about whether the income that councils get from charging, whether that was going back out on services. And again, certainly the information, we have no information to suggest otherwise. When you look at what councils are spending on social care, we don't get the impression that they're holding money back from social care. And in fact, the discussions we've had with specific partnerships over winter, where there's been particularly heightened issues of delayed discharge, local authorities have been pretty upfront about coming up with additional resource in that tripartite arrangement where we were putting money in, health boards were putting money in, and councils were putting money in as well. And so I don't get a sense that they're holding any money's back.
Jackson.
Secretary. We've had a few changes in the committee since the petitioners presented this petition, and I wonder if I could just give voice to, I think, the sentiment that underpinned part of what they were trying to say to us. And that was, given that the power exists under the Act, they are concerned that although it seemed the sensible thing to do to try and get a sensibly negotiated arrangement, it has taken a considerable amount of time and nothing really, as they see it, has been forthcoming of substance, although I take note of just what you've said to us in the evidence you've submitted. I think you're right to seek to get the voluntary agreement. What I think I really want to know is there any justification to their sense that there's been a lack of rigour within COSLA in pursuing this issue over the time scale? Because I think their feeling was that not an awful lot had been happening, and that perhaps, given that you ultimately had a power, the government might have been encouraging a little bit more actively some sort of resolution of the issue. And I just wonder if you could respond to their sort of suspicion of that kind of lack of initiative and drive.
I think they have made some progress, and obviously I understand the frustrations of people who would want to see faster progress on this, of course. I'm sure that is the case. However, they have made some progress. So trying to get 32 local authorities to agree to a new financial assessment framework in itself is something that I think has taken a bit of time, because you're talking about what should be disregarded, what shouldn't be disregarded, and trying to bring continuity to 32 local authorities around that isn't without its challenges. And I think, to be fair to COSLA as well, in the midst of them looking at that issue and fairer charging, they've also been looking at the whole issue of integration. So they've been working on the national indicators to agree what the 100 million for delayed discharge is going to deliver in terms of the integrated partnerships, what they are going to deliver in terms of those national indicators of the 72-hour discharge standard, keeping people out of hospital, getting people. So that's a huge agenda. So the same people, I guess, within COSLA who have been working on all of that have also been looking at the fairer charging issue. So I think, to be fair to them, they have had a lot on their plate around this whole agenda and have been trying to keep all these balls in the air and make progress on all of them. And whereas I can understand the frustration that people might feel that pace has been too slow, a lot of these issues are very, very complex and have required us to have very detailed discussions around each aspect of them. And I think that's perhaps by way of explanation maybe why it's been a bit slower than people would have liked.
Quick supplementary on the back of that. Is consistency ultimately achievable? In their evidence, Argyll and Bute, for example, suggest that the geography of the council area is such that it will always be difficult to achieve a degree of consistency that some might regard as reasonable, depending on how easily they are able to access services elsewhere. Is that an insurmountable obstacle, or do you believe that that concern they have about the breadth of the council area they have to represent is something that could be overcome?
I think there will always be differences around, perhaps around the edges, because if you look at the requirement for travel, if you look at the requirement, a whole host of things, challenges of delivering services and being able to actually access services in a remote and rural area is a different challenge from that in an urban environment. However, I think where the financial assessment framework is helpful is that some things are about, well, what's disregarded as income in one local authority? Why is it not disregarded in another? So if you move from one local authority to another, the differences of what is charged for or what is disregarded in the financial assessment are very, very varied. And I think that's where COSLA had really accepted that variation was too large. So if we can get those big inconsistencies marshalled into a better place of more consistency on things like what is disregarded, not disregarded, then the differences are more about the things like rurality and the nature of the local authority area rather than a decision about what is disregarded on someone's income and not disregarded. So I think we will get to a better place, I think, through the financial assessment framework. Whether that eradicates every difference, it probably won't, but I think it will be a much fairer financial assessment than we have at the moment. But we obviously will want to look at that very closely as it emerges from approval from through COSLA's structures.
Kenny?
There's been a specific concern raised by Inclusion Scotland and a more general caveat and warning put forward by the Equality and Human Rights Commission regarding compliability with the UN Convention on the Rights of the Persons with Disabilities, in particular Article 19. Can you tell us whether the Scottish Government thinks that you're compliant and indeed what work's done to ensure that you are compliant?
Yeah, well, we've looked at the evidence provided to the committee on this today, and you know, we don't consider that the general charging framework is incompatible with the acts and conventions highlighted. I mean, obviously, we would keep that under review in the light of any further evidence that comes forward. Obviously, we also have to make sure that anything is consistent with equality legislation, and we've done that. However, that doesn't mean that there's not improvements that can be made on the fairness. It may not be incompatible with all of those, whether it's the UN Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities or whatever. But that doesn't mean there's not scope to improve the fairness of it. And that's where we're focusing our attention at the moment.
Yeah. I suppose you've said under the equality impact assessments you would have take the same view that you've had a look at that and
yes, the Equality Act itself has as you're probably aware, a general duty and a specific duty on local authorities, both of which are relevant to the development of charging policies. So it requires you to look at that having, you know, a policy that looks to eliminate discrimination, harassment, victimisation, advance equality of opportunity, promote good relations between persons who share a relevant protected characteristic and persons who do not share it. So the causeless charging guidance states that as a result of the general duty, local authorities must consider how to promote equality, ensure that no group are put at a disadvantage by their charging policy, and that local authorities should carry out equality impact assessments on their non-residential care charging policy to make sure that there's not a disproportionate impact on people with a protected characteristic. So they have to do all of that. I guess that's more thinking about if the policy was fairer to one section of the community rather than another in terms of one group over another. And I guess whether people feel that the existing charging policies are fair or not, I don't think they penalise necessarily one group over another. It's just that perhaps one local authority has a different charging policy than another local authority, rather than differing policy within that local authority, if you see what I mean. However, having said all of that, I think what I've said throughout this evidence session is that that doesn't mean that there can't be more done to make it fairer. So there's one thing being requirements under the law. It's quite another thing about whether or not something can be made fairer. And I think that's the territory that we're on.
Can I conclude on that issue of fairness? Ian Hood, the Scotland coordinator of the Learning Disability Allowance, I thought made a very forceful and reasoned contribution to our discussion in relation to what has changed in recent times. And that is that the income tax allowance has increased significantly. And whereas councils were able to charge at 6,000 or 8,000 for over 65-year-olds, and that level used to be consistent with the income tax threshold, income tax threshold is now 10,000 and is set to go higher. So there are individuals who are no longer regarded as being subject to income tax, but who, because this threshold for charging hasn't increased, find that they are regarded as being capable of meeting charging costs. And I just wonder, en route to abolition as a principle, which I think we touched on earlier, whether that issue of fairness is rather exposed by that discrepancy which has arisen over the period even that this review has been underway, and whether that might not be a route at least to try and alleviate those who are least able to afford the charging.
These are some of the discussions that we're having with COSLA around, you know, looking at the issue of inequalities and those who are on the lower incomes, and how we would we could do more around making it fairer from that perspective. You'll forgive me for maybe not getting into too much of the detail, but I think there is a recognition that those who are on the lowest incomes is, you know, an area that we probably need to do more about.
I will take comfort from that.
Any further questions? Okay, is there no further questions? Will the committee agree that we reflect on the evidence heard and consider a paper by the clerk at the next meeting before deciding what action to take?
Agreed.
And can I thank you, Cabinet Secretary, for attending, and I now allow you to go.
Okay, thanks very much, Convener.
Thank you very much. Could we suspend for a couple of minutes? I believe there's a number of petitioners from the mesh implant waiting to come in, so suspend for a couple of minutes. Moving on, colleagues, the agenda item number two is consideration of new petitions, and the next item of business is consideration of one new petition. The new petition is PE1546 by John Crossan on collecting poll tax arrears. Members have a note by the clerk and the petition. The petitioner has indicated that he no longer wishes to proceed with his petition. On that basis, I'll invite members to agree that the petition should be closed.
Agreed.
The next item of business is consideration of seven current petitions. The first two petitions were taken together and are PE1098 by Lynn Merrifield on behalf of Kingseat Community Council and PE1223 by Ron Beaty on school bus safety. Members have a note by the clerk and the submissions. In relation to PE1098, the committee agreed to defer consideration of this petition and seek an update from the Scottish Government in 2015. This will be requested and available for the committee's next consideration. I invite contributions from members. There's no contributions. Could I ask the committee if they agree to write to Transport Scotland requesting that it take account of the petitioner's most recent submissions, highlighting breaches of Transport Scotland school bus safety guidelines, and to defer further consideration until the evaluation report is available in late summer, and to take any other action the committee considers appropriate. Thank you. Can we suspend for a couple of minutes? Colleagues, the next petition is PE1493 by Peter John Gordon on the Sunshine Act for Scotland. Members have a note by the clerk. Two submissions were received after papers went out. Also, a further email from the petitioner. So you might like to say that it is unhelpful for submissions to be received after papers have been issued and that the committee gives everyone it writes to sufficient time to respond. In the case of the Scottish Government, the committee expects in future that responses are received in good time. Can I invite any contributions from the members?
Thanks, Convener. Yeah, just to place on record my disappointment that the Scottish Government hasn't responded to date. Your suggestion that notification be given to the government that we do expect timely responses should be sent.
Okay. Any further contributions? Mr. Wilson?
Convener, I think the petitioner has submitted further information which I think should be passed on to the Scottish Government, because in their response they did allude to the fact that the petitioner hadn't provided additional information. So it might be useful to forward on the latest correspondence we've had from the petitioner and ask the Scottish Government to respond to the issues raised within that as well, because clearly the Scottish Government are saying that they're looking for something that can be brought in that basically is fit for 2015 and beyond. I think that's what the petitioner's looking for, so I think they can concur on that, but the difficulty is trying to get the appropriate action taken by the Scottish Government to ensure the petition is meaningfully considered by the Scottish Government and, in particular, by health boards.
Yeah. I think it's fine that the delay was certainly dilatory by the Government. It does seem to me, though, that there's a willingness to look at this. It is rather complex, given that you're bringing together how various health boards are operating. It seemed to me that, by all means, we should be passing on the information that's come to us from the petitioner to the Government, but we've got to give them some opportunity to bring together and focus what work it is that's ongoing and what they're actually going to deliver. I don't think that can be done quickly, because it's quite complex, given its interaction with other activities, both within the NHS and elsewhere, but pushing them to try and either keep us abreast of matters or indicate perhaps a clearer timetable of what action is taking place.
Can I say I'm delighted to agree with Mr. McCaskill?
Can I just slightly throw a discordant note in with this? According to the information we have, there was guidance issued in 2003 to health boards to establish registers. We're now in 2015, and clearly the petitioner has highlighted that a number of health boards don't have a register in place and have no intention, according to the petitioner, of putting a register in place. I think if we are looking at 12 years down the road, the health boards haven't taken on seriously the guidance issued in 2003, then I think it is incumbent on the Scottish Government to ask why they haven't taken on board the guidance issued in 2003 and why action hasn't been taken before now to address the issues raised. And as part of the letter received from the Scottish Government, the response actually refers to we haven't had any issues raised by patients or family members. I think what we've got before us is a petition that is clearly raising issues, and they should be addressed accordingly by the Scottish Government. And if it takes 15 years for guidance to actually be refreshed and reviewed and implemented, then I think 15 years is too long.
Any other questions? Could I ask the committee then that we should write to the Scottish Government, obviously welcoming the announcement, that it will conduct a wider consultation on the issue and seeking a firm timetable for this work. And can we also agree that in doing so, the Scottish Government's view on the effect the forthcoming EFPIA code on transfers of value of pharmaceutical companies to healthcare professional healthcare organisms will have on what the petition seeks? And also could be taken board the points that Mr. Wilson has made. Agreed?
Agreed.
Thank you. Moving on to petition PE1521 by George Eckton and Jane O'Donnell on No More Phase 3 in the Scottish Sun and in the Scottish Parliament. Members have a note by the clerk and its submissions. I would like to maybe bring to the members' attention that I've been recently appointed to the SPCB, and I'm on record in saying that I support the No More Phase 3 campaign. Can I invite any contributions from members?
I'm minded to move that we close the petition on the basis that actually we've actually fulfilled what was asked for us within the petition, which is not actually the issue itself. The issue was for the matter to be drawn to the Scottish Parliament, which we've done. I suppose we could, if we wished, make a further representation to the SPCB But our responsibility under the petition wasn't to ultimately resolve the issue itself, but to highlight the issue within the Scottish Parliament, which I believe has now been successfully done. So I'm not quite sure what the next step for this committee would be in taking the petition forward.
Any other comments? Angus?
Thanks, Convener. I certainly support the No More Page 3 campaign, and it did look a week ago or so that they had been successful, but that doesn't seem to have been the case with regard to their overall objective. But I think, the committee has, as Jackson Carlos says, done what it's been asked to do, and I think we're maybe straining into dangerous territory if we're deciding whether or not a particular publication is for sale within the Parliament buildings, and I think that that is a decision that should be left to the SPCB.
Would you like to refer this petition back to the SPCB, or do you want to close it?
Well, my own view is we have written to the SPCB, and my understanding is they have discussed it, so my view would be that we should close the petition, I think. Doesn't mean I'm in a reflection on the issue of substance, but I think we've taken the petition to its logical conclusion.
Members agree with close the petition?
Yes.
Okay. The next petition is PE1525, Catherine Fraser on the access to justice. Members have a note by the clerk, paper 8 refers, and a letter from the convener of the Justice Committee. Can I invite contributions from the members?
And I think a lot of work is ongoing at the Scottish Legal Aid Board and the Scottish Government about how you protect the integrity of a legal aid system that's under financial pressures. I can understand the desire for actions by individuals equally since time immemorial and the establishment of legal aid to avoid a growth of defamation cases. There's been no public policy interest. It would seem to me all we could do is write to them, because I think we are in a state of fluidity as legal aid changes and tries to come to terms with court changes and legislative changes, to ask whether there's any willingness to change the current public view. But I think it's very difficult at the present moment for them to bring it in on its own without a wider review of legal aid.
Okay. Any other comments?
Agree.
Okay. The the next petition is PE1530 by Spencer Fieldes on behalf of the Scottish Secular Society on guidance on how creationism is presented in schools. Members have a note by the clerk. And the submissions, can I invite members for any comment?
The committee has expressed a willingness within Parliament to review and has already taken a particular view on this. It would seem to me if that committee is willing to look at it, we should send it to them.
Agreed on that?
I think that might be what we end up doing. I have to say, I've read many of the submissions that we have received, which are basically, and I have tremendous sympathy with this, characterising creationism as supreme bilge. And I think the issue thereafter is whether or not it should be taught in school. Now, the view of the Scottish Government and of the EIS and the SLS is that they don't believe a prohibition would be the right way forward. And my own view, when we interrogated the petitioners, was that, to my mind, anything should be subject to the light of day, and that I don't believe that when these issues are raised, that individuals and also their families, who after all, parents have a role in all of this, don't bring out the truth in people's minds as to whether or not they regard creationism as science, which I think seems to me to be unlikely. But the Scottish Government have said they didn't see merit in banning it. So Whilst I can see we might therefore refer it to the Education Committee, I don't know that the Education Committee is going to be able to do anything other than write to all the very same people to whom we've written to receive the very same replies back. Now, if the committee feels that would be a useful thing for us to do next, then fine, but I'm not actually sure that we haven't had a fairly comprehensive and forceful response from the Scottish Government and from the teaching unions and professional bodies, none of whom believe that a formal prohibition in law would be the right way forward.
John.
The issue, and I may be corrected on this, but the EIS, the School Leaders Scotland, who were challenged, but it must be said, by a head teacher who wrote in an individual capacity, Alec Wood, who a number of us around this table will know, and others indicated that there was professional safeguards built in. But the difficulty is, as I understand it, and the problem that we encountered in particular schools that were highlighted when this petition was presented to us, was that there are no such professional safeguards in place for classroom assistants or others that come into the educational settings out with the teaching staff. And I think the issue for us is quite clear that while we are not saying that people should be stopped from coming into schools in particular circumstances to present their case, the issue for us is whether or not it was appropriate in the circumstances that happened and highlighted in the petition for those situations to have actually arisen. I do think it would be worthwhile sending this on to the Education Committee, because I think there are a number of issues that have been raised, particularly in light of some of the submissions that we received, which have highlighted there are the constraints within the English and Welsh education system, but we don't seem to have any constraints on what's taught in the Scottish education system. So I think it may be useful if the Education Committee are prepared to look at those issues and how the Scottish system compares with those in other jurisdictions, and particularly in light of the response we received from the Scottish Government.
Angus, do you want?
Yeah, thanks, Convener. Having read the submissions, I think one of the most salient point was one raised by the Free Church of Scotland, who state that politicians seeking to enforce their doctrines through the state education system is the mark of an authoritarian, not a democratic state. And they went on to say that the petitioners are demanding that children be told what to think. The Free Church of Scotland believes that children should be taught how to think. And we believe that in a mature democracy, sceptical questioning and alternative points of view should be encouraged rather than banned. So from the responses that we've received overall, there's clearly no appetite for the government to interfere in this issue. However, as John Wilson's just stated, there may be a need for further safeguards. So I would be content to refer this petition to the Education and Culture Committee.
Can I just ask Jackson, both Mr. Wilson and Mr. MacDonald, in the first instance, is that not actually a call for us, as this committee, having got to that point, to write ourselves to the Scottish Government again, drawing the point on classroom assistants and others that Mr. Wilson has identified, to see whether the government believe they have taken that into account in the response that they gave us previously? I'm just not quite sure why we are passing this on when I don't know that if we feel there's an issue that we would still like further clarification on, our normal course of action would be to seek that clarification ourselves.
I'd be happy for the committee to explore the issue further if that's the will of all the committee members, and then possibly look at referring it to Education and Culture Committee if need be.
I have to say, I was persuaded by Jackson's more initial point, because it did seem to me that if it's at the end road, it's really a matter for the Education and Learning Committee to decide whether they want to go anywhere further. They might very well decide not to do anything with it. I would be hesitant for us to do anything more other than either remit it there, and if they say they don't want it, I think we've done as much as we can to focus it and got some clarity on it, and it's for them to decide if they wish to pick it up and run.
David? I'm happy to refer it to Education Committee.
Okay. There seems to be, and probably I would tend to agree with Mr. McCaskill too, that perhaps we, and that's a first for me too, Jackson, and I would refer it to the Education Committee, and then I think it's up to that committee to decide what they should do with it there. Okay, then. Agreed. The next petition is PE1534 by Claire Simmons on behalf of Planning Democracy on equal rights of appeal in the planning system. Members have a note by the clerk and the submissions. I invite any contributions from members. Any questions? Mr. McCaskill?
The government's made its position quite clear in terms of not seeking any rush to further legislation that's satisfied how matters are bedding down. Again, as with the last petition, if the Local Government and Regeneration Committee wish to go somewhere with it, then that's a matter for them. But it almost seems to me that we've explored the issue as best we can, got some clarity, and going back to the government, I don't think it would necessarily take us anywhere further than where we are at the moment.
Yes, thanks, Convener. I would agree with Mr. McCaskill. I think, given that the petitioners have requested that the petition be referred to the Local Government and Regeneration Committee, we should accept that request and refer it.
Happy to support that, Convener.
Yes, support. Could we maybe... Well, OK, then. We agreed then that we refer us to the Local Government Committee? Agreed. OK. The next petition is PE1517 on polypropylene mesh medical devices. And could I welcome both Neil Finlay and John Scott to this part of the meeting. And as members are aware, due to the weather in New York area, Adam Slater is unable to appear by video conference today. I know that has come as a disappointment to obviously many of the petitioners here today, and others who have contacted me are also here in the gallery. We have a note by the clerk and two submissions. Could I suggest that we reschedule the evidence session with Mr. Slater, and could I ask what are the views of the members?
On that point?
Yes, I'm happy to support that.
Right, and is there any comments, Mr. Finlay?
Just in relation to how this proceeds, Convener, I wonder if maybe you or whether the committee has come to any conclusions as to how this proceeds before I make any comment, how we take this further.
I have a point which would lead us to that stage, but I have to say that obviously as a committee, we were appalled by the evidence that we heard, and I think as a committee we were enormously encouraged by the action of the Cabinet Secretary in suspending or calling for a suspension, and I think we've been somewhat disturbed that this has nonetheless proceeded in a number of places. But I have to say that underneath all of this, I'm now increasingly concerned by the drift of travel in the various reviews that are taking place to which we have previously referred, particularly the review that is being conducted by the Medicines and Healthcare Products Regulatory Agency, who it seems to me are moving towards recommending that the benefits outweigh the risks in terms of proceeding with mesh implants, and are also, notwithstanding that, saying that they've come to that conclusion despite the fact that there is evidence of underreporting, and there are concerns that the MHRA is not aware of all women who have experienced problems. And this seems to me to potentially be quite a dramatic obstacle to what many of us thought was progress. Now, I don't know whether it's competent, convener, I'm not actually sure. Are we able to invite the MHRA to give evidence to this committee? Well, I think as part of our process, we really ought to, when they get to the point of concluding their review, which I think is in March, I think we really ought to be seeking to take evidence ourselves from them, because I'm concerned that their report may give considerable force to the direction of travel of governments, and I mean beyond our own shores potentially, despite the fact that there is a very considerable concern on our part that the rather glib assessment that the benefit outweighs the risk seriously fails to represent the very considerable concerns that we have heard from many of the people who have given evidence to us. And I think that we could see what we thought was tremendous progress actually going into reverse. And I think we've got a responsibility to take evidence and to pursue this issue thereafter. I think it may well be that this is an issue we would like to open to wider debate still on the floor of the Parliament when we have an opportunity so to do.
Mr. Carlo, for that. Could I say a number of things? I think it's very disappointing that Mr. Slater can't give his evidence, and that's perfectly understandable given the weather conditions that we see in the US at the moment. Since the Cabinet Secretary announced his alleged suspension of mesh, we know that this is still being fitted inside the bodies of women in Scotland, but just it's now called a clinical trial. Since then, we've also witnessed multi-million pound compensation claims being paid out to several people, with thousands more sitting in the pipeline. And we have a whole range of other issues related to this ongoing scandal about the whole ethics of how medical trials work, about the involvement of professionals in those trials, about the people who sit on these review bodies. There's a whole range of issues in here, very tangled web that we have to unravel now. I think if we're going to get all of this out in the open, and out in the open it must come, then it is up to this Parliament to do that. Now, whether that is through this committee having an inquiry, I don't know if it's within the remit of this committee, I've never sat on it, I don't know, or that we ask the Health Committee to have such an inquiry, or whether we bring the committee can bring a committee debate to the floor of Parliament. Something has to happen to allow us to debate all of these very complex issues that relate to this case. And maybe, in just in summing up, could I say that Mr. Slater's analogy that he gave in the Sunday Mail at the weekend, I think, was a very powerful one, in which he said that politicians wouldn't allow a car on the road if 1 in 10 crashed and injured people. Now, for 9 out of 10 people driving those cars, the benefit outweighs the risk. For 1 out of 10, then crashing that car could end their life or dramatically change their life. Are we saying that we're going to allow that to continue to happen in Scotland when we know what has happened across the US and across the world? So my appeal to you would be today that I'm quite happy to come back and very keen to hear Mr. Slater's session, but that the committee makes some sort of decision very soon as to how it wants to proceed with this and bring this either to the floor of Parliament or have a more in-depth inquiry. Because every day that we delay, then the potential is that another woman's life is ruined.
Mr. Scott.
Thank you very much, convener. And I identify myself with the foregoing remarks by colleagues. I too am disappointed that Mr. Slater can't give evidence today, but for obviously entirely understandable reasons. I'm concerned about the different approach by different health boards to this issue. And I'm concerned, given the precedent that's being set in America, about the financial liabilities that may be being incurred by individual health boards in terms of compensatory payments being required at some subsequent date. Ultimately, that will come back onto the Scottish Government. I'm disappointed that the MHRA may not be aware of all the risks or problems, apparently almost by their own admission. And what's the point of a body if they admit that they're not aware of all of the risks? And I therefore think that it's absolutely right that they should be invited in front of this committee to explain themselves. Mr. Finlay draws the analogy of one in 10 cars being defective. I don't think that's an acceptable standard, certainly in transport, and I cannot see why it's an acceptable standard in health matters, and particularly mesh implants. So I would support the view that this must be investigated much more fully than it appears to have been. If this Parliament is taking the lead in a worldwide sense in that regard, then all power to its elbow.
Any other contributions from members? Well, could I say that, as I said from offset, that we should reschedule an evidence session with Mr. Slater as soon as possible. And with regards to an invitation to the MHRA, I think we should do that. But my understanding of being advised that we can't compel them to attend, but we'll endeavour to do that. With regards to whether we should perhaps have an inquiry, I would have thought rather than, you know, I don't know how the process would work for us, but rather than inquiry, it could very well maybe be quicker for a chamber debate to take place in that issue. So the action I think that I can do from this committee is, one, we can very quickly get in touch with Mr. Slater, and second, we'll contact the MHRA. And then that should be, I believe, the end of our evidence in that respect, which will allow us then to have that report ready for where we can then send it to. But I think with regards to, I think, a chamber debate, if that could be fulfilled rather than inquiry, might be, a quicker way forward.
Yeah. Can I just remind colleagues that the Scottish Government have an independent review which is taking account of the MHRA inquiry under the chairmanship of Dr. Leslie Wilkie, which will make its own recommendations based on the MHRA review. And I would have thought that if, in fact, they do, then as well as the MHRA, we might want to invite the chair of the Independent Review Group also to give evidence so that we can understand their thinking based on what they've heard as well.
Mr. Wilson.
Thank you, Chair. I support Jackson Carlow. Basically, as well as having the evidence from Mr. Slater, the MHRA in front of us, and the chair of the independent review body, it may also be useful to bring back the Cabinet Secretary for Health, because while the initial discussion that we had with the previous Cabinet Secretary, this committee was under the impression that all mesh implant operations had been suspended pending the inquiry, and clearly that didn't happen, and some health boards are using the issue of clinical trials as a way around the suspension. So it would be useful, before we have the chamber debate convener, to hear the evidence from the Scottish Government officials, as well as the Cabinet Secretary, MHRA, as well as Mr. Slater, because I think there are still issues that we need to examine, because what I wouldn't want us to do as a committee is to ask for a chamber to debate with all the evidence, without all the facts being before us and the results of MHRA's evidence-seeking inquiry, because I think there are some concerns that have been raised in terms of the Department of Health response to this committee, is that there's clearly are not doing a full trawl of all those who have had mesh implant operations to find out whether or not there have been benefits. And I know Mr. Finlay made the analogy of the 1 in 10, but clearly, as we have already heard in this committee, that a number of the patients are only now coming forward because the campaign that has been developed and the discussions that have taken place within this committee. So I think it's incumbent on us to make sure that MHRA are doing as full an inquiry as possible before they present evidence, and likewise the independent inquiry set up by the Scottish Government does the same to ensure that we actually truly reflect the situation that's out there and not what is hypothetical or suspected to be, because we know from the evidence we've received so far, convener, that not all medical staff have actually reported where there's been complications, and some patients haven't been aware who to report the complications to. So I think we really need to make sure that any inquiry that's carried out is a full inquiry and takes on board the views and experiences of all those patients that underwent these operations.
Mr. Finlay.
Two things I think on that. Time is of the essence here, because if we, the more we delay, then the more potential there are for more people to be, in my view, victims of this growing scandal. So therefore, time is of the essence, convener. And if we are going to get people in to do evidence sessions, I can, having not spoken to the petitioners today, but I can almost guarantee that the same number of people will be here each time there's an evidence session on this issue. These are probably the most determined and diligent campaigners that I've came across in a long time. Therefore, given the pain and suffering that many of these people have and that is a challenge to them being here, can I make an appeal that if there is to be sessions, that it is one session that all of the people who are invited attend, rather than us have three or four sessions where people who find it very difficult to travel and walk have to come here time and time again.
Any other comments? David?
Thank you, convener. As the Commission gave evidence at the end of last year to the European Commission, the European Commission have a report coming out early this month. It might be worth asking them to give us evidence as well. I invite you to.
Okay. Can I, any further questions? Could I maybe sum up then? I think there are probably four or five action points. One, again, is that we very quickly get in touch with Mr. Slater to give that evidence. Two, we invite the MHRA and the chairman, chief executive, along. Three, we write to the new health secretary, inviting him back for an update. Four, we give consideration as to whether it will be a one-off agenda item, and we'll try to accommodate as many witnesses as we possibly can on that day, but obviously that has to be logistically, we need to look into that. And third, and the fifth point is that we also invite the European Commission. Have we agreed?
You said, convener, just so I'm clear, you said that we would invite the Cabinet Secretary for an update. We write to the Cabinet Secretary, ask for an update. That means the Cabinet Secretary comes here to give the update rather than a correspondence.
Yeah, we'll invite the Cabinet Secretary to come back to the committee.
That's fine.
Yeah? Agreed? Agreed. Okay, then. Thank you, colleagues. I formally close the meeting.